Who is going to carry out the transformations that would make permanent revolution a reality in countries like Egypt and Tunisia?
Communist Manifesto has been described as the single most influential document in the 19th century, apart from perhaps the Charge of the Light Brigade, maybe, or Mrs. Beaton's cookbook. But anyway, it ranks pretty high up there. But I just want to begin by talking about one kind of influence it's had that hasn't really been much discussed. It wasn't only partly responsible for the Bolshevik Revolution, which is obvious. The Manifesto was also a kind of model for a whole series of successive, succeeding manifestos, which were produced by the great revolutionary artistic avant-gardes, all the way from Futurism and Constructivism in Soviet Russia to Dada and Surrealism in France and elsewhere, right the way through to the last of the great avant-garde, Situationism, which died the death in about 1972 and played such a leading role in the events in Paris in 68. There was a sense in which the Communist Manifesto, quite unwittingly, provided a sort of model or template for a whole new kind of document. The very idea of a manifesto as a kind of polemical intervention which would set out a whole new agenda, and this concept was taken up by the great avant-gardes. These documents were always collectively produced, and indeed the Communist Manifesto was collectively produced not just by Marx and Engels, if that's a collective, but actually produced on behalf of the Communist League of the time. Yes, and typically their language is full of sort of satire and scabrous insult and ridicule and extravagant fantasies, sometimes admittedly of a rather adolescent variety. Language, however, I'm talking about the language manifestos of the great revolutionary avant-garde, language which is alive with the urgency, with the insistence of its historical moment, with the sense of history as moving under your feet as you write. You're having to move very quickly, as it were, to keep abreast of historical change. And these manifestos were the product of artists who wanted not simply that art should reflect the revolution, that culture should register politics, but rather who wanted to revolutionize the very form and concept and meaning of art itself, to break down, for example, the traditional barriers between art on the one hand and politics on the other, so that, for example, to take a celebrated instance, on the third anniversary of the Bolshevik Revolution in Petrograd, the great Russian theatre director Meyerholt, who was a great influence on Bertolt Brecht, took over the whole town with something like 50,000 cast, many of them soldiers and sailors who had actually played a part in the real Bolshevik Revolution a few years before. Battleships, you know, real guns, battleships. Thing went on for about 3 days. Meanwhile, back in England, we had E.M. Forster. Wasn't sure I'd get a laugh so early in the proceedings, but anyway. So, interestingly, the manifesto inspired not only political revolutions, but artistic ones as well, that saw themselves as political, in a certain sense of the word. It was a new kind of literary form. It was really a new kind of genre, one in which words were also weapons, which didn't just reflect or register a situation, but actually saw itself as intervening constructively into it. It was a description of the world which was also a way of changing it. And there's a traditional name for that, which is rhetoric. Rhetoric is a description of events which is also an intervention into them, and the manifesto inherited that very venerable form. Now, I'm not a political theorist, I'm just a sad survival of an endangered species known as literary critics. Pretty useless bunch. I mean, not even A.C. Grayley would take us in. you know, we just say things like, you know, wasn't that bit on page 98 fantastic? And the ending was very sad. And somebody else said, no, it was all crap, you know. And that's basically kind of learned discourse that we have at this kind of level. But anyway, let me just give you a hint of how a literary critic, dying and protected breed, might look at a bit of the manifesto. Marx and Engels say at one point, the bourgeoisie, wherever it has got the upper hand, has put an end to all feudal, patriarchal, idyllic relations. It has pitilessly torn asunder the motley feudal ties that bound man to his natural superiors and has left no other nexus between man and man than naked self-interest, than callous cash payment. It has drowned the most heavenly ecstasies of religious fervour, of chivalrous enthusiasm, of Philistine sentimentalism in the icy water of egoistic calculation. Now, what's the tone of that? You know, don't put up your hands, please, you know, okay, because I'm going to tell you in a minute. You know, so it would be premature as well as silly for you to do that. I mean, is the passage admiring the bourgeoisie, the middle classes, or is it denouncing them? The callous cash payments, on the one hand, doesn't sound too admiring, drown the most heavenly ecstasies of religious fervour and Philistine sentimentalism. That certainly sounds a lot more positive, doesn't it? Well, the answer, of course, is, in fact, it's doing both together. Yep. And this tonal ambiguity, this stylistic ambiguity, I think reflects a genuinely dialectical stance towards the middle classes, towards the bourgeoisie, namely that Marxism uniquely, I think, applauds the middle classes as the most revolutionary force in history to date, and of course also as a brutal oppressor. And indeed, I think one of the best reasons for being a Marxist, quite apart from annoying people that you don't like very much, is that nobody else I know, at least you know for the present, tells these two utterly contradictory stories together, tells each, as it were, out of one, each side of their mouths. Modernity, the modern period in particular, the period of the bourgeoisie, the period, let's say, since the European Enlightenment, as on the one hand, and on the one hand, exhilarating emancipation, and on the other hand, one long nightmare. As Marx says, the nightmare, the burden of all history weighing like a nightmare on the brains of the living, and moreover, not just on the one hand, on the other hand, in that classical liberal gesture, but actually the one in terms of the other. What are the mechanisms, Marx is asking, which generates a history which is on the one hand superbly emancipatory and on the other hand deeply oppressive? And I think the language of the manifesto is posed at a kind of knife edge here. In fact, there is in it a shift of pronoun. When Marx begins discussing the middle classes in the first few pages, he speaks in the third person, and he's qualifiedly admiring of them, as I say. Later on, however, he veers abruptly into the second person. He starts buttonholing them, addressing them, and accusing them of self-contradiction. Anyway, the point is that you can always tell a Marxist by the fact that he or she is so nice to the middle classes, right? That's what distinguishes us from various brands of postmodernist, as well, of course, as so nasty at the same time, yeah. The language of the manifesto simply flies off the page. I mean, like Hamlet, it's full of quotations. It's crammed with a kind of boundless energy. It's flushed with a sense of the sheer excitement of a relentlessly revolutionary, dynamic, international class. But this class is the bourgeoisie, not, in the first instance at least, the proletariat. It's a long hymn, it's with a long hymn of ambiguous praise to the bourgeoisie that this key document begins. Unlike all the artistic manifestos which follow in its wake, which are much more one-sidedly polemical than that. Nobody can say that Marxism doesn't give the devil his due. And that's because, as one reason among several, because as far as Marx is concerned, without capitalism, socialism is sunk. Yeah? With admirable generosity, the bourgeoisie has spent its time, unknown to itself, preparing the conditions for its own demise, preparing the conditions that will fund, both as it were spiritually and materially, fund its own successor. Socialism, to Marx, takes a ride on the back of capitalism, and this is another of the manifesto's sort of sick jokes, or, you know, bits of comedy noir. This, of course, mind you, raises some very tricky issues, which I don't think Marxists have at all adequately addressed, but which you can find brilliantly analysed in the remarkably cheap and extraordinarily attractive book called Why Marx Was Right, which is somewhere on sale in this building, and which, for a very modest fee, I will append a signature to, and for a rather more substantial fee, will write a thank you for your having inspired the book. If socialism needs to draw on the accumulated resources of capitalism in order to avoid Stalinism, to put it very crudely, does that mean that Marx thinks that capitalism is a good thing, or partly a good thing? Anyway, more of that later on. To continue the literary terms, the bourgeoisie is also presented here as a truly tragic class, here and in other of Marx's writings, because, like the traditional protagonist of tragedy, it overreaches itself and brings itself to nothing, and it does that, can't help doing that, it does that simply by the built-in dynamic of the kind of eternally transgressive, agitating, self-dismantling sort of class that it is. Like Faust, or like Lear, like the great tragic protagonist, it's full of energies and desires which prove fatally self-destructive, which undo themselves in the very moment of triumph, which can't help undercutting themselves as the fruits of this class's ambitions turn to ashes in its mouth. So the real irony for the manifesto, out of several ironies, is it's not the working class, which is anarchic and disruptive and excessive and out of control, but the capitalist system itself. As Walter Benjamin remarked, revolution isn't a runaway train, it's the application of the emergency brake to a system, to a history, to a formation, which is itself continually lurching out of control at great danger to the lives of those, as it were, within it. So that, in an astounding sort of twist, really, this so-called political order that Marx is anatomizing in the manifesto is itself a kind of anarchy. Rather, as for Freud, a little later, Marx's compatriot, the drive for order and civilization, creating order and civilization, ironically conceal the destructive frenzy of the death drive within the very constructive drive to create order. For Freud too, although in a very different sense, there's something self-undoing, potentially self-marring about the whole business of building civilization. So that Marx's vision in the manifesto is of a kind of sovereignty or political order or authority which is itself disruptive, transgressive, disdainful of boundaries and restraints, and which is powered by a kind of voracious and infinite desire, by a kind of Faustian desire. The moment it stops desiring and aspiring, like Faust, it's done for. A desire which wants nothing less than to gobble up the whole world. And that's ironic, because then that desire has no object against which to define itself. That's one way in which it keeps for Marx undercutting itself. So that nothing for Marx is more surreal and more freakish and more fantasy-ridden than this apparently sober, hard-headed, you know, money-obsessed, pragmatic form of civilization, just as nothing, in his view, is more magical and fantastic than money. Nothing, as it were, materialist about money for him in the least, a kind of magical illusion. So that, in an extraordinary irony, in the manifesto, capitalism is in one sense moribund, dead on its feet, washed up, you know, past its sell-by date, but the paradox is that it's also too manic and dynamic by half, so that one excellent reason for being a socialist is just to try and get some sleep. So, if we're talking in literary terms, and I'm doing the talking, and I've decided we are. At the centre of this document, an astonishing set of paradoxes or ironies. Not only the ones I've just mentioned, namely the sort of ironic double-edged judgment on the middle class, not only the irony of order itself being a concealed kind of chaos, but the fact, of course, above all, that the capitalist class gives birth to its own gravedigger, a kind of grisly irony to the working class, that it can't help doing that, that's part of its nature, that in its very life it creates the conditions for its own demise. Modern history for Marx turns then on a kind of set of ironies which are, if you like, the literary equivalent of social contradictions. Like Dr. Frankenstein, the middle classes are haunted and devastated by the work of their own hands. And the manifesto is a kind of Gothic horror story, in another sense too, as living labour under capitalism is just a means to increase dead labour, namely capital. Capitalism sucks its lifeblood from the dead. So if the working class is Frankenstein's monster, the middle class is Dracula. And as far as this mixture of literary forms goes, I mean, historical survey, horror story, political rhetoric, call to arms, there's even an element, you might say, of science fiction in the manifesto. Eric Hobsbawm has pointed out that Marx and Engels are actually a bit too generous to the achievements of the industrial bourgeoisie at that point in 1848, overestimating, in fact, their global achievements. Even so, as Hobsbawm points out, the situation they describe is really what that class will achieve in the fullness of time. So there's a sense in which the Communist Manifesto is not exactly true. Its description of the middle class is not exactly true, but it will become true in the future. Its portrait of industrial capitalism is, in a sense, all the more accurate by depicting the system in its fully developed potential, anticipating its future, if you like, rather as a historical novel, for example, can be, in a sense, truer to reality by editing and distorting it. It would have been more appropriate, for example, if Florence Nightingale had died while nursing some fevered young soldier in the Crimea. You know, but the fact is he lingered on in quite a long way into the 20th century, actually, not doing very much except dying there. In other words, as we all know, history doesn't always get things right, and it occasionally needs to be corrected among other things, art. In fact, history, of course, is full of the most absurdly implausible events. I mean, Henry Kissinger being awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. Or a stunted Corsican corporal conquering half the world. I had to rehearse that tongue twister several times, which no self-respecting novelist would indulge in for a moment. History is strewn with half-finished characters, carelessly abandoned subplots, preposterous coincidences, crashing anticlimaxes, unresolved enigmas, and snatches of lurid sensationalism. Nobody would believe the thing for a moment. It's a paranoid Georgian peasant slaughtering millions of his people, for example. I mean, who would believe that? Balzac and Tolstoy would have done the whole thing a lot better. Speaking of novelists, there's also a sense in which the manifesto is a kind of fiction. Does that mean it's false? No, any more than Macbeth or is false. Fictions don't necessarily ignore facts. There are other facts in fictions. A novel might tell us that Donald Rumsfeld is a ruthless little bastard, which is true, and indeed is a quote from Richard Nixon, who ought to have known. But generally speaking, fictions massage facts to fit their own moral and imaginative purposes. The facts aren't there for their own sake. There's a lot of historical analysis, of course, in the manifesto, but it's not there for its own sake, as it might be in a scientific treatise. It's there as part of a rhetorical strategy. When the manifesto tells us, for example, that working people should unite because they have nothing to lose but their chains. That's not true. That's palpably not true. They have a great deal more to lose in certain situations, including their lives. But it's not meant to be taken as a factual proposition. Yes? Language which is not false because it's not meant to be true to reality in the first place, rather as a statement like, you know, whose woods these are, I think I know, is neither true nor false, or once upon a time, there was a typical middle-class nuclear family consisting of 2.5 bears, you know, is actually meant to be true or false either. I'm sorry, I strayed into literary criticism again. I don't seem to be able to help it. The aim of these statements have a peculiar kind of status because they're not meant to be describing a reality, but there's a sense in which though they're not true now, they may become true, no guarantees, but they may become true if you're persuaded by them, take them in a certain way, and act upon them. They aim to create the conditions which will help to make them true. Their truth, as it were, lies in the political future. It's not true either, for example, literally, that the whole of human history has been the history of class struggle, as the manifesto famously declares. I mean, if that small scratch on the back of my hand that appeared and disappeared last Wednesday counts as a historical event, and okay, I'm not putting it up there with the Spanish Civil War or the suffragettes, and I know my limits, then it's hard to see how it counts as part of class struggle, unless a policeman bit me when I was asleep, maybe. I'm going to have to cut to a rather gloomier conclusion, missing out some extraordinarily brilliant stuff that you now just never know. You know, it'll be one of those events, historical events that will never be realised. Just let me end by going back quickly to the case about, is it true that that for socialism, capitalism is in some sense necessary. It's obviously not true, as Lenin knew, that you had to be capitalist, your particular nation had to be, but is it true that somebody somewhere had to be capitalist? Marx seems to have thought that, though he's ambiguous at various times, and he could have been wrong about it, but even if it's true, then it doesn't mean, I think, that the misery and wretchedness of class society can then be seen as retrospectively being justified by the emergence of socialism. And in that sense, I think Marxism is a tragic kind of creed, which is again often underplayed by Marxists. Not tragic in the sense that it doesn't believe that there might be a fortunate outcome to history, of course it does, but in fact many tragedies have a fortunate or a relatively fortunate outcome. You don't have to end badly to be a tragedy. Not because of that, but because humanity has to be hauled through hell in order to get there. You know, I mean, some of us may be born by the train of history, you know, to this desirable destination, but what of those who died in the tunnels and perished in the sidings, those whose very existences have been consigned to oblivion? How long would socialism have to survive, and how vigorously would it need to flourish to justify all of that history? Could it ever do so? I mean, even if class society finally issues in socialism, it's perfectly possible, isn't it, for Marxists and others to ask, in some sort of counterfactual way, would it not have been preferable if class society had never existed, and if so many lives had not been fruitlessly wasted in that way? And for those leftists who are all too ready with their denunciations of pessimism, you know, with their cheery, upbeat triumphalism, one can simply say, is this, after all, not pessimism, but sheer sober realism? Thank you very much.
Yeah, so I'd be interested to know, I mean, the sort of view of the manifesto that I think Terry's given, I mean, if I understand correctly, where, yeah, we're seeing it from the point of view of literary criticism, we're not seeing it as a set of, as it were, kind of empirical propositions about the way the world is.
Well,
Right, yes. Yeah, so we're seeing the manifesto as a literary construction. We're not seeing it as a series of propositions necessarily about the way the world sort of empirically is. I find that attractive, certainly as a counterweight to a lot of the, you know, empirical focus that we get throughout the socialist movement. But I'd be interested to hear Terry's thoughts on the relationship between this version of the manifesto and the possibility of political action. I suppose, I mean, it reminded me of some of the things that I've read that Terry said about Christianity as a form of, I can't remember if this is the right phrase, but a form of tragic humanism. I think that was it. If we read the manifesto in this way, is there a relationship between the socialist movement and other movements, like past Christianity, for example?
Okay, I'm going to take three speakers at a time and then ask Terry to come in and answer, and then after that take another round of speakers. So.
Yeah, the first time I read the Communist Manifesto, I was in a garden shed next to a pile of dog food, because that was the only place that I could find any quiet to do so in. But it occurred to me, completely irrelevant that, by the way, it occurred to me at that point, a very similar thing came to mind that Terry said. If we have to go through all this suffering to get to a socialist society, how can that be justified? It kind of occurred to me at that moment that that maybe wasn't the correct question for me to be asking. And a phrase that wasn't particularly, you know, it's a pop culture reference that was about 20 years out of date, but it into my head just popped the song "We Didn't Start the Fire." Yeah. Now, obviously, yeah, capitalism and the periods of time that led to capitalism have been absolutely abominable. That's no, through no fault of ours, but obviously it's down to us to try and rectify that problem as best we can. That's all I wanted to say, really.
I suppose something is always lost in translation, but alas, my German is now far too rusty to give any kind of scholarly answer to that, except that, I mean, there are so many versions of the manifesto in English, aren't there, that read so fabulously, where I say the language possibly leaps off the page. I was in Germany, I was speaking in Berlin partly to escape the royal wedding, but I emerged from Berlin airport, and the very first thing I kept seeing were a whole lot of signposts saying wedding. Some of you may know there's a suburb of Berlin called Wedding. I just thought this was the kind of Germans paying a sort of symbolic homage, that they were pointing towards Westminster Abbey, you know, from Berlin, whatever. I wasn't, on the point about empirical facts in the manifesto, I wasn't meaning to argue that there aren't, it doesn't try and tell it like it is. I think it does try, and I think for the most part it's successful. What it meant was, it's not a document to be taken simply or mainly at that level. As I said, there are plenty of empirical facts in novels as well, you know, but we call them novels because we take those facts in a certain way and in a certain context. We take them, in this case, you know, within a kind of rhetoric which is trying to get us to look at the world in a certain way in order to do things. A quick comment on the point about tragic humanism. I have spoken about both Marxism and, I think, psychoanalysis, I mentioned, and Christianity in a certain interpretation of it, as all involving a certain tragic humanism. And I've contrasted that with what I call liberal humanism. The contrast being, briefly, that liberal humanism thinks that essentially human energies are good, are inherently positive and creative, and the problem is that something out there is stymieing them. Something is sitting on them, oppressing them, and so on. I think actually quite a lot of the time Marx believed this. Marx speaks as though, on problematically, human energies, powers and capacities, as he calls them, are inherently positive and then become morbid or negative by virtue of being repressed, alienated, deflected, and so on. I don't think that's true, actually. If that's what Marx does believe, I think he's wrong. Because I think that a tragic humanism is one that believes that our powers and capacities are such that in order to become authentic, they need to undergo a radical breaking and remaking. Yeah. And that's not just a matter of, as it were, finding their expression, bursting out, but that's a much more complicated process, the political name for which, of course, is political revolution or transformation. But there are other kinds of names. Yes, the final speaker was absolutely right in pointing out that as far as the question of does capitalism, do we need capitalism for socialism goes, even if we do, we didn't create class society. Yes, the question is, how do we take advantage of a history that we see as largely negative in order to, as it were, create a new history? So we'll try that.
The woman speaker here will be followed by yourself.
Yeah, it's just a very brief question, actually. I wanted to know what you thought the impact of the Paris Commune, its successes and failures of, was on Marx and Engels and the Communist Manifesto, because I do believe they altered some aspects of it following the Paris Commune.
Yes, I think probably people weren't quite expecting a literary critique of the Communist Manifesto, which may explain why perhaps there's a certain reluctance for people to put their hands up. Probably people were expecting a sort of political argument or whatever. And I think what Terry's done is actually very important, because I don't think any of us read the manifesto simply, so to speak, because we wanted to find out facts. I think we probably read it or were impressed by it precisely because that language that Terry's talked about points in the kind of different directions in terms of irony and satire, as well as a fantastic promise as well. And I think that is important, because I think one element is that as socialists we don't simply look at the facts and expect history to do things for us. We do think about how we can be energised by what's going on in the world and make a difference. And I think that is a kind of important aspect. I think the specific points that Terry raises about is capitalism a good thing or is the Enlightenment a good thing, these are, in a sense, real questions, aren't they? I mean, there's, first of all, the kind of historical one about how those Marxists in Russia, some of them, simply saw capitalism as a good thing and therefore started to apologise for capitalism because it was superior to feudalism and ended up, in effect, supporting the status quo. And I think to come up to the present, think about how, in terms of wars in Iraq and so on and so forth, the notion that we are defending Enlightenment values has been used as saying this is what we need to bring to backward and benighted societies. So I think that kind of argument is important, because we wouldn't want to throw out Enlightenment values, but we would want to see the contradictions, the inherent contradictions of a system which promises certain kinds of things based on certain kinds of advances, but at the same time is used as a way of enslaving and crushing certain other things. I think that's important, and I think that therefore does lead to this question about looking to the future and what Terry talks about in terms of both human energies. I think the thing about human energies, I think probably Terry's right in terms of there is that one particular strand, but there's also another strand, it strikes, perhaps not just in Marx, but later in Marx and perhaps in Engels, where there is an argument to say there are kind of certain limits to what humans should be doing. I'm thinking of Engels' comments about how we have to relate to nature, for example, which is not simply a question of submitting it to our energies. It's a question of a kind of symbiotic relationship with nature, and you can't treat it as simply a thing that we do because it'll come back and attack us. And I think that's very much what we can see in terms of the environmental movement, the question of global warming and so on and so forth. So I think there is a kind of refinement going on in terms of thinking through that kind of thing. But the final thing I think that's important is, if you like, this question of our relationship to capitalism. I mean, I think the comrade made the point about, well, we're not in control at one level. We didn't make it. So if capitalism brings these particular things, it's not, so to speak, that we think, oh, goody, goody. It's more that here we are presented with a horrible situation. How can we make the best of it, given that there is both a potential and a barbarism within it that is there. And I think, therefore, you know, when, just to, I mean, Terry's made this point as well, but I mean, one of the things the manifesto does say is, of course, it talks about the victory of the proletariat, the fall of the bourgeoisie and the victory of the proletariat are inevitable, but which sounds as if it's just going to happen. There's another element where he says the possibility is the common ruin of the contending classes. So really what we do makes that kind of difference, how we do think through our relationship to that particular past, how our energies are going to be deployed, is an important aspect. And I think Terry has drawn attention to that in the manifesto, and I certainly would recommend everybody to buy his latest book. So I'll give you a plug, Terry.
While Terry was in his grammar school doing art subjects, I was the other side of the CP Snow, two cultures, doing biology, chemistry and physics. In fact, this handicap has been reflected in elsewhere by Terry, who has described scientists as being unspeakable yokels from grammar schools with dandruff on their collars, who thought Rambo was a cinematic strongman. Sir, I have no dandruff on my collar. I'm not wearing a collar at the moment. But seriously, about the Communist Manifesto, being a scientist, I really can't get to grips with philosophy very easily. But I looked up Wikipedia, Neo-Marxism. This is an interesting page about to be deleted, so see it while you can. They speak about the sort of things you might find in the New Left Review, where Marxism has been adapted, modified, reconsidered over the last 150 years. And one thing that particularly struck me and appealed to me was the shared idea amongst neo-Marxists to move away from the idea of a bloody revolution to one of a more peaceful nature. This is the essence of my question. I've been lucky enough to take part in two unsuccessful revolutions overseas, Paris in May 68 and Trinidad in 1970, a black power revolution. And I was scared shitless. I've never been so frightened in my life by the violence perpetrated by police and army. And I must say that I'd like to keep the revolutionary message with less of the red, less of the blood about it. How does this square with the manifesto? Over to you. Thank you.
Point about the Paris Commune. Yes, it's almost as though in the Paris Commune, which is of course a very short-lived event, and which sometimes has been maybe mystified almost beyond its limits, but that in that Marx and Engels did see what they were arguing in the manifesto actually being realised. And they saw it not as a model of socialism. In fact, Marx, I think, at some point comments on the non-socialistic nature of quite a lot of the communards, the people involved in it, but actually as an example of the sort of self-governing radically egalitarian and democratic society that they were looking for. So there is, and that moreover, at a period when Marx and Engels were relatively pessimistic, you know, after the high point of 1848 about the fortunes of the working class movement. Suddenly this event sprang into existence. The Gareth, I'm very pleased that Gareth made such a fine blurb for my book. This is because I taught him many years ago, you see, and he's paying me back. You know. I should actually point out, and Gareth quite rightly referred to the way in which Mensheviks really believed in the development of capitalism as a necessity to have socialism. Clearly that we want to be critical of, except that Marx himself actually at one point does talk about the need for the development of German capitalism. Yeah? So Marx sometimes himself suffered from this idea. As far as the final comrades goes, I do swear that when I talk about scientists as unspeakable oiks with dandruff, I was being satirical. I was quoting what I imagine was a certain traditional classicist, humanist portrait of scientists. I mean, scientists have been among the most left-wing of intellectuals, of course, and have had a very traditional alliance with Marxism, come to that. On the question of non-violent revolution, well, this is brilliantly and deftly dealt with in a certain chapter in my remarkable book. All I can say is, of course, we share those fears too. Marx and Engels were very much committed to the idea of possible of a non-violent revolution and believed in the possibility of it. Not least, of course, because revolution is not a coup d'etat, you know, because it's not an adventurist uprising of some, you know, wild-eyed, shaggy-haired adventurers against the huge, formidable power of the state. What revolution has, by definition, at its disposal, to its advantage there, is the fact that it has such great numbers. And for Marx, it wouldn't be a revolution did it not. It's nevertheless true, of course, that we know from bitter experience that ruling classes have more tanks than we do, and also that they're not at all reluctant to use them in certain kinds of conjuncture. But nonetheless, we've also seen not long ago examples of ruling classes caving in, giving up, because they were confronted with a power that they knew was much greater than their own. Ruling classes can't, nobody can survive by violence alone. Yes? Nobody can overthrow a state by violence alone, nor can states survive by violence alone. Even the most brutal of states, like, for example, think of South African apartheid, need to take some cognizance of the subjective experience and feelings of their people. Yes? In the end, they won't do it simply by coercion. And that makes a difference, I think, to the question of violence.
I'm going to take the next four speakers at the moment. So this will be the man in the white shirt here, followed by the woman in purple, followed by the woman in red, followed by the man up there in the red check shirt.
Hi, I just want to ask, what do you think is the relation, or if there is any similarities between the manifesto as a text, and maybe religious books? Certain types of religious scriptures like the Quran, or I mean, especially in this second person style and this messianic element and this kind of, you know, better time to come, or and why did we at a certain point lost this metaphor of God? How does Marx actually thinks that when, well, how religion thought that God was maybe the one that, or this concept that can instaure some form of social justice, now it's the contrary. I mean, God becomes, or at least religious institutions through this idea of God, become the dominant ideology that keeps social forms of injustice. Thank you.
Yeah, you mentioned psychoanalysis. Is it this? Just on the topic of psychoanalysis and Marxism, and I wondered if you could say something about those 20th century Marxist thinkers who have tried to marry psychoanalysis and Marxism. And I was thinking about, in particular, Eric Fromm and his discussion of Marx's concept of alienation and some of the ideas that he's brought about. I think he would be quite interesting in this context. So yeah, if you could say something about psychoanalysis and Marxism.
I also have a question, which is, do you think the manifesto or Marxism represented in the manifesto, or, you know, element of that, is teleological? If so, is it a good thing? If not, is it a good thing?
You spoke about the Communist Manifesto as Marx, but we know it was Marx and Engels. So what was the relative contribution of Engels to the text? And what would you say about the literary qualities of other works that were indisputably only Marx, Capital, the Gottlieb Program, and so on? And how were these received by the Terry Eagletons of their day?
I'm just going to take another couple of speakers, be yourself and followed by yourself. And if anyone, there still is, you know, some time to indicate. So if you've got something you want to ask, just stick your hand up and I'll try and fit you in.
It was refreshing to hear the manifesto spoken about in terms of rhetoric. I was just going to think about that word in relation to what it is that the organised Marxists do today, particularly with some of what the things that Lenin has to say about slogans, and also the word rhetoric. Rhetoric itself may have a shelf life and may become outdated. And think about the word rhetoric itself also can be taken in a pejorative, colloquial way to mean something that people are suspicious of. If you think about a phrase, the rhetoric coming out of the White House, or, oh, that's just rhetoric. It can also mean a kind of speech, a kind of language which people are just intrinsically suspicious of, partly because people may think, oh, well, we've heard that before, so there might be a way in which rhetoric has a shelf life. I think I already said that. So I suppose a question which I was going to put, what strategies might there be of keeping rhetoric fresh and keeping the arguments that rhetoric can be used to express, but finding new ways, constantly new ways of expressing arguments, which may well, you know, have a long history to them, but that they might need to be sort of thought about differently to concretize the particular moment in which we exist. And so the slogan is a way of doing that, a slogan which can sort of typify and capture the contradictions of a very particular historical conjuncture. So I suppose the question I was going to put really was, what strategies do you think, or what strategies are there for keeping rhetoric fresh and stopping it sort of slipping into that pejorative sense in which the word rhetoric is used?
Yeah, hi. It was just a quick comment in response to the question of a peaceful, bloodless revolution. Because I do believe the October Revolution was once described as the bloodless revolution because the majority of the working class and peasantry at the time did support the revolution. And the defenders of the old regime basically scattered initially. What was violent was the response to the October Revolution. The ruling classes, the captains of industry and the landlords and the white armies, they were violent. So in some respects, I think it's unavoidable. I think this also, I think, brings me to the issue of the comrade earlier who asked a question about the Paris Commune. Because, yes, Marx did, in fact, I think in a preface, in a later edition, make an amendment. He said, at last, with the Paris Commune, we have found the political form in which to realise the economic emancipation of labour. And what he meant by that was, we can't just simply take on the ready-made state machine, the apparatus, as it is. We have to destroy it, we have to abolish it, and create a machine that acts as a... is it like an anti-state that will reintegrate the state into the body of civil society? Because unless we do, the state machine will be turned against us because it has been perfected over hundreds of years by successive ruling classes to preserve their privileges. So what was my other point? Oh God, I've forgotten. Yeah, I think I'll leave it at that. Yeah, cheers.
Yeah, just a contribution that sort of links to a couple of other people's things. But somebody asked about what contribution did Engels have towards the manifesto. And I think historically, it was drawn up for the Communist League, and Engels had been involved in drawing up something different beforehand, which was more of a catechism, a confession of faith of what it is to be a communist, and sort of bullet points of we believe this, we feel that. And the manifesto actually has elements of echoes of that in a sense of its language and its word in the way it's presented, but it also brings in a scientific approach to looking at society and looking at the way of changing society and bringing about socialist society. So there's a blend in that sense of bringing a different sort of scientific approach to looking at the world into what was more of a religious-ish, moralistic approach of talking about politics and socialism. And I think that we could look at it as in that sort of context, historically, as a particular document of its time.
Hi. I think it's just a small comment. It's worth thinking about the manifesto form, I think, as a barometer for for struggle and the level and the ebbs and flows of politics. Because Terry started off by talking about the way in which the manifesto form was extended into that avant-garde artistic culture from the futurists, the constructivists. We might even put it slightly earlier, actually, with Pizarro. But it goes, I think, through that period into the early 70s with the Situationist International, who create some of the kind of final examples of that form. And then all of a sudden, the manifesto seems to have stopped for a while. And it's quite interesting to think about why that should have been. And I think in many ways it's no coincidence that postmodernists, for instance, didn't produce many manifestos, unless we want to think about some the odd weird text in Simio text or something. But that's because I think for those attacks that postmodernists made on the avant-garde were always linkages or ways of attacking revolutionary politics. And I think that the attacks on the avant-garde, the arguments about the vanguard, always went back to an argument about the connection between those kinds of politics and a kind of art form. And so that the art forms actually became a kind of way of just gauging that temperature. And my point is just, it's very interesting that recently there's been an enormous outpouring again of manifestos in contemporary art. And they're coming from Russia, they're coming from the old Yugoslavia, they're coming from the East. And so what we're seeing again, probably since the late 1990s, is a resurgence of the manifesto form. And I think that for me actually suggests that what we're actually seeing is a revitalization of that political movement and of the tempo that we associate with it.
Just like to pick up on the point about keeping rhetoric alive and making sure it's still valid or needs to be rewritten or something like that. Of course, is what we do all the time. But it's made me think of one feature of the literary style of the manifesto around its use of time. Because in describing how the bourgeoisie came to being and quite an early stage, 1848, and describing how the proletariat develops, time it does write in a historical way, but also there are these great flourishes of poetry which somehow condense time and mixed all up together. So almost in the same breath, we've got this tale, this phrase about the monks expelled from their monasteries, which is going back like 300 years before Marx. And then he's talking about exalted professions such as lawyers tumbling into the working class as well. And who could possibly think of such a ridiculous thing of that as that even 10 years ago? And yet I heard recently of a call centre somewhere in the south of England where there were 200 qualified solicitors sitting at desks answering questions. So we've got this condensation of time in the flow of the manifesto's language in a way that I think does keep the rhetoric alive, but it also matches some of our reality now. Just briefly, I was in Brazil a couple of years ago, great, great, great privilege, and walking through the city of São Paulo and having visited the one of the training centres of the Landless Workers Movement, one of their big education centres, and hearing about the democracy they run in the camps, suddenly seemed to me that in this environment, you've got centuries which you can witness all in one day. It's not some fantasy that some post-modernist critic invented. This is something... This is actually a feature of our time, that there's an accelerated pace of living and historical experience.
I'm going to take three more speakers, and then I'm going to bring Terry back in to sum up for 10 minutes. So the first speaker will be the woman over there with the sunglasses, followed by the man in the front row here, followed by the woman in the green top up here.
I just wanted to think about some things that Terry said and also that the gentleman in the green shirt was talking about. And obviously, this was a talk on a manifesto, so that's what we're thinking about. And immediately it made me think of the recent manifesto marathon that was held at the Serpentine Gallery. I don't know if anybody went to it, and I'm from an art background, so that's the direction I'm coming in from. And obviously at this marathon, there were lots of people thinking about the forms of manifestos and also the fact that manifesto making can be very problematic. And also the fact that we often sort of allied futurism and constructivism, although they are obviously quite different in their nature, and futurism has lots of very problematic elements, especially when we think about feminism and futurism and fascism. And so as we're talking about rhetoric, and lots of people are saying how do you keep rhetoric alive, or this rhetoric is really strong and really powerful, I think it's also important to think about postmodernism and the challenges that it had to the rhetoric of the manifesto as being interesting as well. You know, things like feminism and anti-colonialism, these challenges are important challenges to the way in which we speak and the arguments which we make, which I think, you know, to think about all sorts of manifesto making now is important. And I don't know if you had any thoughts on that, or where you felt feminism had a place with the Commons Manifesto. And that was it, basically.
Hello, Sean Leahy from Coventry. I'd just like to say two things. One is to Terry, to thank him. It's the first time, although I've been to Marxism sometimes, I've ever heard Terry speak, actually, and I will buy his book now. But I'd like to thank him because I remember him with much affection for something I read many years ago. I love Thomas Hardy's novels, particularly his later novels. And Terry wrote an introduction to the book Judy Obscure, in which he defended Thomas Hardy from those who treated Hardy as if he was some crude fatalist. And I've always remembered that. And he, in fact, Thomas Hardy was the first novelist, actually, from a working class background, who actually wrote about ordinary, you know, agricultural labour as the centrepiece of his novels, and was hated by the literary establishment at the time for it. So thanks, Terry, for that. But one thing I wanted to make a point was that... yeah, sorry. Is that okay? I wanted to make the point that the two strands that people have talked about on the Paris Commune by Karl Marx came up, and the point about bloodshed and revolution. Actually, there's a big link that hasn't been made, because I remember reading on the Paris Commune many years ago, and the first point of Marx writing that book on the Paris Commune was to defend the Paris Commune against those who justified the repression of that commune by its violence, and by showing how the violence that occurred in the Paris Commune was as nothing compared to the reaction, the violence of the reaction, and how terrible that was. The rivers of Paris, you know, flowed with blood, etc. And it was a very important point that also shows that actually it's not the revolution which is the bloodshed, it's the reaction if you lose, you know. And I mean, if you take the high point, like the October Revolution, say, in Russia in 1917, what actually led to it was an attempted coup by Kornilov, which gave the workers and the masses in Russia an inkling of what would happen if they didn't act now to make the decisive choice about the future of Russia, and if they let the reaction win. And that was really a decisive point, and the fact that the Bolsheviks led the defence led the defence of the provisional government, liberal government, against that coup, gave them the leadership in the October Revolution. And actually, it's a very important point. If you look at what happened to Allende in Chile, a massive reaction had occurred because of the failure to build a revolution in that way, and not having an organisation like the Bolsheviks, you know, capable of doing that, I think is actually a fundamental reason, I have to say unapologetically, why we need a revolutionary party like the SWP, so that, you know, we're able to actually build to make sure but when we're in this situation, we have some organisation, not necessarily the SWPP in its present form, you know, I'm not trying to be sectarian in that way, but we need an organisation that makes sure that we win. That way we get the bloodless revolution.
Yeah, I want to come back to the issue of the literary form of the Communist Manifesto, which I think relates quite a lot to the question about authorship. I think the literary form of the Communist Manifesto has to do a lot with how the Communist League and Marx and Engels in particular felt that they could make their ideas accessible to people. So it is correct that there was a form of catechism at first, and then Engels was particularly critical of this form, and he thought that they should devise a form that actually breaks away from all these religious connotations that this form implies. Then Engels wrote another document, a credo, which it was in a form of questions and answers, and then he was quite unhappy with that as well and felt that there should be a document which gives a bit of a narrative about history and historical processes and how historical change comes across. And he proposed that Marx wrote the manifesto, so the Communist League assigned it to Marx to write this document. It is true that Marx used bits of the credo that Engels wrote and incorporated into the manifesto, bits of the conditions of the working class in Britain and so on. So to acknowledge this particular debt to Engels, he acknowledged him as a co-author, and that's why we have got two authors. It is undoubtedly true that Marx wrote the text, but of course, as I said, this is the references to Engels' work. Now, again, to come back to the literary form of the manifesto, I think the question was for the Communist League how they can open up to the masses, okay, how they could make their ideas more accessible to people. And that was a time where the Communist League wanted to break away from the secretive operation that they had. And I think we can see bits of this effort within the Communist Manifesto itself. You have got, for example, not only the format with the manifesto in itself, but also you can see it when they talk about the translations of the text, that they felt that this is something that is a document which is written to be translated. And you can see it in the very first lines of the text that they say this document will be translated in this many languages. It didn't right away. It took some time to be translated. But you can see that this effort, that these ideas have to be made available to people all over the world. And of course, at the end of the Communist Manifesto, the final section of the manifesto also betrays this scope that, yes, we do need to open up, we do need to engage with people. And of course, you will read that the final section is how, it's a tactical chapter, how do we engage with existing organizations of the working class. And I think that is quite an important point, a turning point for the communist movement, because it really does open up, you know, Marxism and communism to this is something that everybody can engage with and is not just a secretive organization of a few.
Okay, I'm just going to make a couple of announcements before I bring Terry back in to sum up. Firstly, immediately after this session, there'll be an SWP Disability for Action meeting at 5 o'clock in the Gavin De Beer Lecture Theatre. This is open to all SWP members and supporters. It's a reminder that Bookmarks, the socialist bookshop, is open in the North Cloisters and Haldane Room throughout Marxism, with a range of books for activists, including second-hand books at bargain prices. You can also come down to the front. There's a stall here full of Terry's books and relevant books to this meeting, including the Communist Manifesto itself. Terry will be willing to sign copies of his books if you want to come down to the front. It's also to say that, as well as the Jeremy Bentham and South Cloister bars, there's going to be a barbecue on the roof garden from 5 until 10 tonight. And the comedy night, Hysterical Materialism, is going to be back in the old refectory. So let's bring Terry in.
Well, from the Quran to Thomas Hardy in 7 minutes, I think. So. Is the Communist Manifesto the same kind of text as the Quran? Well, my subtle, nuanced and ambiguous response to that is no. Communist Manifesto makes no claim to be, not only does it make no claim, of course, to be a sacred text, it actually claims to be a desacralizing one, yes? And in that, it acknowledges its indebtedness to the bourgeoisie, once again, because, of course, it sees the middle classes themselves as the great secularizing, desacralizing force. That's not, on the other hand, to say, of course, that raises, but I can't pursue, the enormous and important question of Marx's relation to the Judaic and Christian traditions. It always seems to me strange that some Marxists think it's rather coy about the fact that Marx, as a secular Jew, owed some certain kinds of themes and motifs to the great Judaic emancipatory traditions. The Day of Reckoning, the thirst for justice for a whole people, yes, the notion of some kind of redemption or transformation. You know, it seems to me that there's not simply a continuity between Marxism and Judaism. Of course, Marxism isn't just disguised religion, but neither is there any kind of absolute discontinuity either. One thing, of course, that Marxism and Christianity have marvellously in common, which makes them very akin, is they both have turned out to represent squalid betrayals of their leaders. You know, swap Stalinism for the Inquisition, if you like. Right. The question of psychoanalysis and Marx is an enormously important and fascinating, and I think thrilling, question from, but also Marcuse and Reich and Benjamin and others. Lots of ways in which Marxism and psychoanalysis, as both emancipatory projects, clearly have much in common, don't they? And one must reject surely the kind of vulgar Marxist idea that, well, you know, psychoanalysis is bourgeois because it deals only with the individual, whereas Marxism is collective. On the contrary, Marx has much to say about the powers and capacities and flowering and fulfillment of individuals. His thought is relentlessly concrete and specifying and particularizing. Marx is very nervous of abstractions, as against the kind of notion of him as a bloodless clinical theorist. And conversely, of course, Freud, you know, when he was told that, you know, somebody came hot foot to him with the news that Jung had just discovered something called the collective unconscious, Freud said, the unconscious is collective anyway. Yeah? Psychoanalysis is all about trans-individual structures, and in a broad and deep sense, of course, is profoundly political, in that it's also all about the cat and mouse game played by the law and desire. On the other hand, it's not all good news. One can't simply, as it were, stitch these two things symmetrically together. Psychoanalysis, I talked about tragedy, and I think psychoanalysis is a profoundly tragic vista and vision, which is not, of course, to say that it doesn't believe in the possibility of redemption or cure or repair or emancipation here and there, but it reckons the enormous cost that we have to pay for that, the way that there is a kind of primordial wound in our being from which we will never fully recover, which will continue to scar and disable us from the inside. The idea that there is a kind of ongoing trauma there that any project of political emancipation must realistically confront. It doesn't scupper the idea of political emancipation in the least. Freud was very interested in what was going on at the Bolshevik Revolution. But it does raise certain questions about a too sanguine, too triumphalistic, too liberationist notion there, I think. Somebody asked a very interesting question, I wish I could answer it, is the manifesto teleological? That's to say, does it see history as having a kind of built-in unfolding thrust or dynamic or purpose? I'm kind of thinking a lot at the moment about that question. I wish I had a simple answer to that. It's not, I think, teleological, at least in this sense. And of course, Marx isn't arguing that capitalism itself was necessary. It may be that there's some internal relation between capitalism and socialism, but capitalism itself, like any other mode of production, is historically contingent. It's not in the least God-given. There are other paths of development for the productive forces and so on. Nor, of course, does capitalism exist for the sake of socialism, which would be a kind of very hard-nosed sort of teleology. As for Engels, other people have dealt with that much more, in much more erudite ways than I could, and I thank them for that. They've kindly passed over the fact that he did actually ride with the Cheshire Hunt. You know that Engels rode with the Cheshire Hunt, and he was a bit of a playboy as well, I'm afraid. When Karl Marx's daughter, I think it was Eleanor, asked, she used to play a game with Marx and Engels and other people about what's your favourite colour, what's your favourite novel, and so on. And one of the questions was, what's your favourite slogan? And Marx said something very politically correct, like, may the struggle always continue, and Engels said, take it easy. Now, if only we could combine those two, we'd crack it. The comrade who talks about feminism and the manifesto tradition, the manifestos have been disgracefully macho. You know, certainly the futurists, I think she mentioned, constructivists to some extent. The whole idea of building the new man in very large capital letters, mechanistic, externalized, attack the very idea of psychic interiority as irredeemably bourgeois, all that kind of stuff, at which they should hang their heads in shame. I was very grateful to the comrade who thanked me for my preface to Jude the Obscure. Hardy, one of the reasons why Hardy got such terrible reviews for his novels was not that he didn't believe in God, but he was so gloomy. And gloom is socially subversive. Gloom is ideologically undermining, not least if you're a Victorian. What's the point of art? To cheer you up, of course. You know, what else could it be? Art has to be edifying, yes? That's why it's not really ideologically permissible to end a novel. It wouldn't be for George Eliot, wouldn't be for Dickens. It only becomes possible with Hardy. Hardy is the point at which the English novel becomes tragic. Yeah? Apart from one signal and marvellous exception in the mid-18th century, Samuel Richardson's great novel, Clarissa, which is largely unread because it's the longest novel as well in England as well as being great. In fact, a friend of mine was once teaching Clarissa at an American university, and the students were very bravely ploughing their way through these 3,000 pages, or maybe an abridged version of it, and things were flagging a bit, and I was teaching at a nearby university, so she asked me to come in, and I just published a book on Clarissa and Richardson, so she asked me to come in and talk about my book, and I did, and I noticed that some of the brethren at the back of the class were looking at me rather strangely and kind of muttering to me. It suddenly dawned on me they thought I was Samuel Richardson. Kind of little old Englishman with a funny accent comes in and starts talking about his book on Clarissa, and maybe that sense of history had left something to be desired. Just a quick point about the Paris Commune. Absolutely, I think the comrade who talked about the violence of the Commune is spot on. Everybody, every bourgeois commentator talks about the hideous violence of the French Revolutionary Terror, yes? As though there never was a more violent episode. They don't talk about the worst violence that was inflicted on the communards by the reactionary French government. I think with that, actually, I might actually even have come to an end. Thank you very much, sir.